Retro.
Hi, this is Vanessa Marshall, voice of Hera and Rook Cast, and you're listening to Dennis and Jay on Podcast Stardust. Their behavior is continually unexpected.
This is Podcast Stardust.
This station is now the ultimate power in the universe.
With Dennis Keithley and Jay Krebs.
Your behavior is continually unexpected.
The galaxy source for Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion.
Now witness the firepower of this fully armed and operational battle station.
Welcome back to Podcast Stardust. This is the fully armed and operational podcast dedicated to Star Wars news, reviews, and discussion. I'm Dennis Keithley.
And I'm Jay Krebs.
And we'll be discussing episode 4 of Andor in this episode. But before we get to Andor, Jay, can you remind everybody where we are located around the internet?
You bet, Dennis. We are on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Stardust.
All right, this is aligned. The signal is boosted to maximum output. The shield is down, and we're now broadcasting to the galaxy. And that's even more appropriate that I say that when we're talking about Andor
than
anything. Yeah. So again, this is episode 4, and it's called Aldhani. This will be a full spoiler discussion. We're getting into a lot of nitty gritty comes to this one. So not even giving you fair warning, Jay, you want to go ahead and give us the summary of the episode, please?
Oh, I would love to. After escaping from Ferrix, Luthen offers Cassian a job. In exchange for assisting in the heist of an Imperial payroll, Luthen will pay him 200,000 credits. When Cassian agrees, he is dropped off on the planet Aldhani and left with Vel and the other 5 members of their team. Despite their initial reluctance to have Cassian, they begin preparing him for the mission. Elsewhere, the ISB head to Morlana 1 and shuts down the corporate security services there after the disaster on Ferrix. The system is placed under Imperial authority. Disgraced, Cyril returns to his mother and home. Lieutenant Deidre Miro of the ISB also becomes interested in the incident on Ferrix once she hears a Starpath device was recovered and she believed it was stolen from Stiergard, which is a sector she is responsible for. Finally, Luthen returns to Coruscant, where he runs an antiquities gallery. He meets Senator Mon Mothma there, and the two discuss the importance of funding and Mon Mothma's desire to bring in someone that can assist her.
A lot of intrigue in this episode. What did you think about it overall?
Well, again, you know, it was one of those things when it ended, it was like, I just went, huh. You know, I just think that the series is, even though in some ways it seems kind of slow. It's slower than what we're used to with a lot of the, you know, amped up action scenes and that type of thing. But then again, it's doing such a great job of world building and getting us into the nitty gritty of what the beginnings of the rebellion were all about. And I just have to keep reminding myself that these are like chapters in a book, you know, and you have to kind of look at them in that way. That each chapter is building a little more and a little more, and you're being introduced to this concept, these characters, you know, this background or whatever. But I'll tell you what, I am intrigued. And I think that that's why I think this one was 49 minutes, went by so fast for me, is that like once you're in, you're just so sucked in and right. It holds your attention so well. So, I mean, and it's so cinematic and so good in that way. That it's a different Star Wars, but I'm digging it.
Yeah, I like it quite a bit too. And what occurred to me while watching this one is that I think we're looking at a structure where you get an episode like this and it's a setup episode. And then the next episode will kind of carry things a little bit further. And then I'm expecting the third episode to then give us the payoff there where they're going to carry out this raid that they're preparing for and they're going to steal their payroll and get away. And my conclusion for that is that we know they basically set this season up where they had 4 directors and each one of them directed 3 episodes. And so we had one director who did the first 3 episodes and we got that first episode, which was interesting, intriguing. It kind of gave us some details. It gave us the setup, but then the second one advanced the story, didn't provide us a lot of action. That third one was the big payoff. episode where we got the action, we got the resolution to that part of the story. I'm guessing this is going to be a similar type of a thing where we're going to get some setup, we're going to advance the story, and then we're going to pay it off in episode 6. And yeah, it's very, very intriguing. What I think I liked about this one compared to the first episode is that we're a little bit deeper into the story, and we have all these references to things going on elsewhere in the galaxy, and we are now, I feel like we're in more familiar territory. There are these allusions to a growing rebellion going on. The Empire is more directly involved, as opposed to just kind of being mentioned in whispers in the first three episodes. And we get to see Luthen go to Coruscant and deal with Senator Mon Mothma, and there's all this intrigue about their discussion there. But we'll address all those things in turn. But definitely, this isn't the same thing as The Mandalorian or The Book of Boba Fett, where in those stories, you may have a story that begins and carries it throughout the entire season, but each one of those episodes can pretty much stand on its own. There is a beginning, middle, and an end to the story contained. That's not the case with Andor. There isn't necessarily a standalone story in each episode. It is a continuous arc. And so you got to be patient with that when it comes to Andor. And yeah, it's definitely a slow burn.
For sure. But you know what I value so much about it is just the fact that even though it's a different kind of Star Wars, it is the everyday people Star Wars. You know, we know, as much as I love stories about the Jedi and the Mandalorian and all the lore about the Force and Force users and, you know, and I just think that this one is, you know, once again, it's very much in that essence of Rogue One, is in that you're getting to see what the galaxy was truly built on. And I have to say too, as I was watching this, I was picking up, you know, you talk about all these references that we'll get into as we get into our discussion here. But of course, I was picking up on them right away. You know, this particular planet or that company or this species of alien or whatever. And I was like, oh, or that name that was mentioned, you know, towards the end with Mon Mothma. And I was thinking to myself in the way that, like, with my husband sitting there, someone who doesn't have necessarily as much invested in the background knowledge, is that he probably felt very similarly to what I do when I'm watching something like Star Trek. As much as I love it and I know enough about it to understand it, I don't know what all the alien species names are called or the planets, or to be able to place them in my brain and say, oh yeah, I know where that planet is. I know who those people are. I know what that company is. And so I thought to myself, gosh, somebody that's watching this that doesn't have that depth of knowledge, yeah, they're getting a lot of great dialogue and background, but some of it's probably going over their head, which is okay. You know, it's not detrimental to the story that they don't understand it, but you know, I can empathize, I guess, is the big point that I'm trying to make.
Right. Yeah. I mean, in some of these, yeah, there's a lot of passing references to various planets, and a lot of them you'll find like mentioned once in a book somewhere. And so it came back up again here, but you don't need to know anything about that planet to understand this story. Right. Which, yeah, I think is what you were saying there. And so, yeah, it's definitely a beautiful mosaic of Star Wars trivia that they've painted here, but you don't have to know all the details in order to understand this. This is a very interesting heist/spy type of a story set in Star Wars. And they just pile intrigue on top of intrigue, and it works out really well. One of the things I noticed, there aren't any flashbacks in this episode. We don't get any follow-up to the story with Cassa after Marva took him off of Killari there. You know, I'm curious if they are going to revisit that in the future, because it feels like there were enough events alluded to in those first three episodes, like what happened to Clem and Cassian's criminal past with insurrection, assaulting an Imperial officer. And I can't remember everything, but that he's apparently served time for at some point. And, you know, that's fine if they're just going to give us that in dialogue and a little bit of exposition. But given that there were so many flashbacks that first three episodes, I guess I was expecting a little bit of that here. But what was your thought on that?
Well, you know, I think Diego Luna, he was on recently one of the StarWars.com YouTube shows, And he was talking a little bit about that, you know, in the fact that, you know, we, as we were saying in the last review that we did for episodes 1 through 3, that he seemed a lot older than 6 years old. And he mentioned that line, you know, being in the fight since he was 6 years old, is that we're going to get to see the origins of that. And so I think it's coming. And I mean, that's basically what Diego Luna said, is that, you know, it is going to be explored, and we are going to get those answers just a little bit more. And I just, a quick aside, I did get to thinking about that a little bit when we were talking about the children and the flashback and Casa and his sister. And you had mentioned that the clothing seemed like it was commercially produced. And I wondered, after watching it again, and how loose fitting all of the clothing was, and how kind of tattered and put together pieces and parts it was, I wonder if they got those from, I hate to be like this way, but from the adults that might have perished in all of the mining that was happening. So maybe those were some of the clothing that the adults were actually wearing that the children were able to scavenge.
Possibly. Yeah. We'll have to find out in a future episode if they revisit that area there. We're not going to do this discussion in sequential order, because it flips back and forth from everything that Luthen and Cassian are doing to the ISB and, you know, Mon Mothma and Luthen, and then more ISB, then back to what's going on Aldhani and everything else. So I've kind of broken up the discussion here into the individual stories. Why don't we save what happens on Aldhani for last, but we will address the first thing that happens, which is the conversation in Luthen's ship. So they've escaped from Ferrix, and, you know, they're going to lightspeed. Cassian makes a remark that he's been in one of these ships before, but he's never seen it do that, which I think he meant, you know, calculate a lightspeed jump and get to lightspeed so quickly. Mm-hmm. And they're having this drawn out conversation where Luthen keeps pushing Cassian. You know, I know what type of person you are. You know, I came to Ferrix for the star path, but then, you know, but what I really wanted was you. I got much, so much more. And you know, and Cassian's pushing, like, oh, what do you know about me? You know, and he's, I think, a little bit offended by the notion that Luthen claims to understand him so well. But then Cassian does things like throw out, you know, I fought on Mimbim when I was 16, and I was only 50, one of 50 that survived. But then Luthen throws out there, it's like, you went to Mimbim out of prison as a cook.
Be a cook.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And you only survived because you ran away.
Yeah.
And so he really does know Cassian's past. He's really dug in on this guy. So what did you think about this back and forth between these two?
Okay, so Luthen is so intriguing to me now. Mm-hmm. I thought he was such a cool character after seeing him in episodes 1 through 3, but, like, I gotta know what his story is. I mean, because he really did know everything about Cassian. And, you know, Cassian threw out, you know, who are you? I don't care. You know, you could be a sep, you could be a guerrilla, you could be a partisan, it doesn't matter to me, you know. And so who is he really? You know, obviously he's got these connections to Mon Mothma, and he's working very closely with her. I love the antiquities, you know, cover up thing. And I know when we were first kind of speculating, I threw out the idea that he reminded me very much of, like, a Dryden Voss type character, because he seemed like he was very well to do, and yet he was getting his hands dirty with all of these kinds of things. And obviously that's somewhat true. I mean, he's got this big front that he's running as, you know, kind of a ruse to be able to run all of these things for the rebellion in the background. But I want to know how he got started, and I want to know how he's getting all of this network going. I mean, even through Aldhani, you know, with Vel and all of the people there, and how is this working? I mean, I'm so incredibly intrigued by this. I know I'm babbling, but I'm just so impressed by it.
Yeah. But, you know, one thing that stands out to me here about this conversation that Luthen and Cassian are having is that, you know, Cassian wants to go on and do his own thing. And Luthen presented these options. You can do this job. I can drop you off somewhere. Or, of course, you could try and kill me and take over my ship. And, but he basically says he's not going to get very far. And that, you know, Cassian throws back, you know, I can steal on my own. And Luthen says, you know, yeah, so you've been doing so wonderful for yourself that way. Or I just really like the way that, you know, Luthen keeps nailing him down and keeps kind of letting Cassian come back with an answer to whatever question Luthen throws out there. But then Luthen basically shuts down that answer and then guides him back to what he wants, which is to take this job and get this potential reward of 200,000 credits. And the one thing that he says to him is that he knows Cassian's hate and that ultimately he's going to die fighting these, I'm not going to use the word on the podcast, so I don't have to put a clean or explicit label on it, but you know, he's going to basically die fighting the Empire, which we know is exactly what happens to Cassian because he does have that type of hate and he manages to funnel it, you know, towards the Empire there. But then he pushes Cassian to adopt a fake name for everything that's going to happen. And Cassian uses Clem, which we know was essentially his adoptive father. Exactly. So yeah, that was a nice tribute there. Mm-hmm. Okay. This is something I wanted to ask you about all day long. Luthen pulls out a pendant that is a blue Kyra crystal and tells Cassian he's giving it to him as a down payment of 50, and it's you know, don't take less than 50,000 credits for it, but it's worth more than that to me, so it's kind of like a refundable deposit on that. Do you believe this is actually what he says it to be? Because I have two thoughts on this.
Okay, so there is a gold chain around it, obviously, and it's actually partially clear and partially blue.
Right.
So, you know, I'm wondering, it's too big to be a lightsaber kyber crystal, but yet it does seem to have very similar kind of almost, you know, djinn vibes in a way. It's kind of like, you know, it's like poetry, it rhymes sort of a thing. I'm not really sure what the backstory is on this.
There was he tells us the story.
Yeah, but I'm thinking to myself, is that the true story? You know what I mean? Do I really believe that? So I'm kind of wondering to myself, does Luthen have some sort of connection to the Jedi, perhaps? But then I'm thinking, gosh, this is too big. Like I said, it's too big to be a lightsaber crystal. So I hadn't really gotten any further than that, though. So I'm very curious to hear your thoughts.
Well, okay. So kind of getting into a little bit later, a different segment that we're going to save for later. You know, when he does drop Cassian off on Aldhani and he's convincing Vel that she's going to add him to the team. Yeah, she basically is reluctant to do so. And then he makes this comment that, you know, yeah, he's a mercenary, he's a rental, but that means he's disposable. So why would you give something to Cassian if you really truly believe he's disposable?
I don't think he did. I mean, I think he just told Vel that just to
to
placate her.
That's one aspect of it. It's like, who's he truly value more? Vel and her crew or Cassian in this regard? But then, you know, the flip side of this is that later we see he does have this antiquity shop and he's got all these rare and exclusive treasures that are in there. The story he tells Cassian is that this crystal was to commemorate the Rakata invasion. And, you know, it was then given out to all these people. And, you know, now it's got a value of $50,000, but it's worth more to him. When I first saw this, I wasn't buying that this crystal was what he was saying it was. You know, for all I knew, it was just a piece of glass. I wasn't thinking along the lines you were, where, you know, this maybe belonged to a Jedi, because you're right, it is way too big to belong in a lightsaber. But at the same time, it's like, is this just a con that he's pulling on Cassian? Like, look, I've given you this treasure that means a lot to me to get you to do what I want. And then later we're going to find out from somebody else that it's a fake, that it's not really Kyber at all in there. But I feel like the way that they set up this character, there is this ambiguity and we aren't supposed to necessarily know whether we trust him yet or not.
Well, now that you mentioned when he said about the Rakatans, I remember hearing that and thinking to myself, but wait, the Rakata was the one of the homeworlds of the Sith. So that doesn't make any sense.
Well, not necessarily the Sith. The Rakata came up, they're originally from the Knights of the Old Republic game. And they established a star empire using the Star Forge in that game. And they fell to the dark side. And essentially the conquered, they were not Sith themselves. Darth Revan went to their home world and learned a bunch of things, but it wasn't necessarily a Sith planet.
Mm-hmm. And then Bane went back there as well. So,
right. Yeah. Exactly. Okay. And found okay. Revan's holocron.
Okay. As, so maybe that's where my brain was going to dark side Sith, but you're right. Yes. Very, yeah. very important distinction.
This is an episode full of Easter eggs and references. And that was my favorite one right there that they brought up the Rakatan Empire. Because does this mean that they're ever going to do anything with that in the future? I mean, we've known Darth Revan showed up on that bas relief that was on Exegol. Mm-hmm. I think it was in The Rise of Skywalker and stuff like that. So they've been kind of giving us hints about him. It's all Easter eggs at this point. I don't think it's pointing towards them ever actually doing anything more with that character. But I do kind of love that this is like the epitome of legends, the way to do it. You know, just these little hints about this character and these events from something that we're all familiar with, or a lot of us are familiar with, and was so important to us back mm-hmm. in the day, that they've worked it in this way. It doesn't have to be true at all. It could be King Arthur and the Knights of the Round Table with all these different adventures and stories, or Robin Hood for that matter. And we really do have to struggle to separate the fact from the fiction. But I like the fact that they're throwing it in there. I just think that's really cool. That was a really awesome decision that they made.
Oh, for sure. And that kind of goes back to what I was saying before about, like, you don't have to know these things. Mm-hmm. But for those of us that do, we appreciate it so much.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
All right, so let's jump ahead a little bit. Since we're on Luthen and we've been talking about him, let's go forward and talk about him on Coruscant. So after he drops off Cassian, who's taken on the name of Clem, with Vel on Aldhani, we'll get back to that story, he returns to Coruscant, but then he like puts on this wig and all this jewelry and a robe of sorts. He completely changes his appearance from what we've mm-hmm. seen him. And now he's posing as this antiquities dealer on Coruscant. He has a shop that he runs with an assistant named Clea. And then Mon Mothma comes to visit him. What do you think about this transformation? I saw this character in the trailers and didn't realize it was a Stellan Skarsgård. I thought it was somebody else. And it blew my mind when I saw that it was him.
Well, that's why I was saying, you know, when we were speculating about it and I thought he was a Dryden Vos character, that like to me, the hair didn't even register. I just looked at his face. So I realized that it was Stellan Skarsgård, but I guess I just didn't realize that it was him in a wig. Like I didn't even realize the hair was different at the time. But I think this is so interesting in the way that it's setting up for how the rebellion is hiding in plain sight, I guess you could say. But again, this goes back to what I was saying before about how I want to know how Luthen got started with this, because I mean, obviously he's a pretty reputable antiquities dealer, you know, I mean, he's definitely on the high end of like Doc Ondar's, right? So, mm-hmm. because you've got senators like Mon Mothma coming there to see them. And so one thing, just a quick aside, is that his aide, this Clea, was also in on everything, obviously, because they were talking about how, ooh, new driver, and how Mon Mothma was saying, you know, she can't trust anybody and things are changing. And, you know, she goes into certain areas and even in the banks and the workers are different and whatnot, but getting kind of off topic, but at any rate, you know, as far as Luthen goes, I think this is a perfect front for him to be able to get some of these high profile types of people in there like Mon Mothma to be able to work behind the scenes on things.
Yeah.
I have other thoughts, but.
Right. Yeah. I like the way you put that. He's kind of like the legit version of Doc Ondar, because you know, Doc Ondar has got all kinds of illegal stuff and trades right. in the black market realms here. Whereas Luthen is running a shop that's much more on the up and up. I mean, he mm-hmm. seems to legitimately, I mean, a senator is knowingly coming to shop there.
Right.
And she wouldn't be doing that with her driver and all these people who know who she is on Coruscant, who could see her do it. Not even trying to hide her identity if it wasn't a shop that was supposedly at least on the up and up. Now, of course, the shadiness to it is that he's helping to foment a rebellion out of this shop. Mm-hmm. And this show has got such incredible acting. It is the best acting of any of the live action Star Wars that have come out so far. And one, the transformation of Stellan Skarsgård's personality as Luthen, the rebel recruiter, that's talking to Cassian versus Luthen, the antiquities dealer. I mean, two very different people, but he warmly welcomes, you know, Mon Mothma to the shop and, yo, you're here to shop for your a gift for your husband and his day of days, which was an interesting thing that I guess that they celebrate on Chandrila. That's a Chandrilan custom. And so he starts showing the Utapau and cudgel. So that's a neat little Easter egg there. Mm-hmm. But then they go to the back of the shop and they have this very brief conversation about, you know, he's like, I need you to tell me if you're not gonna be able to get the funding. So, you know, that's part of her role. And what, see, I'm not even sure we can call this the rebellion yet because it's in such a nascent stage, but you know, she's acquiring funding and getting some information and she wants to bring in an assistant that can help her. We have no idea who this assistant is yet. And Luthen doesn't want to hear it. He wants to shut that down, but they realize that they spend enough time back there. Mon Mothma makes this point. It's like, you don't think I understand what's at risk here. I'll be the first one to fall. Right. I'm the most visible person in all of this. And so he picks up this other artifact that he's going to send her home with. And he walks out into the shop and then turns around and says to her, it's a daring choice, but I trust you'll have the courage to turn back if it should be a bit much.
So that was, it's like, so good.
Yeah, such a perfectly natural thing to say about this acquisition of this piece that she's made, but it really is wrapping up the conversation they just had in the back.
Exactly.
Such a great, great scene. And that's the thing. It's like, if you are getting a little frustrated with this series because it doesn't have the action sequences that we all love from Star Wars, you are getting this other, these other great moments of intrigue that I feel like really make up for it. That you do kind of have to make an attitude adjustment when watching the show. No doubt about it. But it really is worth it.
Oh, for sure. And I think the payoff at the end is going to be amazing. And I mean, we've already got confirmation of another season. So, I mean, it's just going to keep building.
Mm-hmm. So from there, Mon Mothma returns home. I love her apartment on Coruscant. Yeah. That thing was beautiful. Got a tree growing right through the middle of it, which is really impressive on Coruscant. But she wanders into the dining room where she finds her husband, Perrin, who I don't think we've ever seen before in anything.
I didn't even know she was married.
Yeah, I knew she had a son from one of the novels, which I can't remember which, but that's neither here nor there. But she forgot about this dinner that Perrin is throwing for the governor of Hanna, which I believe is in the same system as Trendrilla. And Mon Mothma forgot all about the party, and she's really frustrated by this. And, you know, but he wants to go forward with it. He offers to cancel. And she's like, you know, I'm not being serious. And, but then there is Slymore and Ars Dangor. So two of Palpatine's like biggest aides are going to be at this party. Uh-huh. And she's like, you know, they hate me. you know, another great reference / Easter egg right there, you know, Slymore. And, you know, because we've seen her in the prequels always around, hovering around Palpatine. And Ars Dangor is one of those guys with the goofy hats that always advised the Emperor in the original trilogy. So, again, I don't know that we're going to get to see this party or not, but
I think it'd be cool if we did.
Yeah. But just kind of seeing the pressure and the stress that she lives under. I can't tell. What's your take on this? Does Perrin understand what she's doing as far as fermenting a rebellion?
I can't decide because I thought in some ways I thought, oh gosh, this guy has absolutely no clue what's going on. But then again, I thought, okay, well maybe he does because, you know, just the way that they had the guest list and everything. I would, like I said, I would love to see this dinner because I think that it would be pertinent to propelling this storyline forward. Just those little nuggets of what was going on, you know, at the time with the Emperor and where everything was going, because obviously Slymore was part of all of that, you know, before, like you said, the prequels, and still is now.
Yeah. Yeah. It would be curious. I'm eager to see what comes of Mon Mothma's and Perrin's relationship going forward in this series. I don't even know if we're going to see more of him at this point, or this was just kind of a, you know, look what she's going through. And because she was just talking about how, you know, there's spies everywhere. You know, there's new people in the Senate every day. She went to the bank and it was all new faces. You know, she's got a new driver. They had to distract the driver in the shop. You know, Clea had to show him some coins so that he wouldn't overhear what they were talking about in the back. You know, Tony Gilroy is involved in the Bourne identity. And, you know, he's got plenty of experience in establishing these spy scenes and things like that, and it really paid off with everything absolutely. That Luthen and Mon Mothma were done.
Okay, well, I wonder if the reason why I never realized that Mon Mothma had a husband is because maybe Perrin ends up either going to join the Empire and they split up that way, or he ends up dying, or maybe he just kind of falls into the background somewhere. So
I'm guessing he's going to die. If I had to put money down on one of those, I know he doesn't strike me as a guy that would betray her, but yeah, I feel like he's not around later for a reason. So we'll find out.
Or irreconcilable differences, perhaps.
That would be sad. Okay. So let's get to the ISB storylines here. And we get some great shots of Coruscant for this. I love that we're going back to Coruscant in this series. And we get this meeting, and it's led by Major Partagaz, who is an older guy with long white hair. And he's kind of a tyrant of the ISB, the way he's addressing all of his inferiors there. But he's getting reports from everybody at the table, and he's really putting them in their place when they haven't done a good report, when they haven't done a good job explaining why it is that they want the resources they want. And he wants particulars. He wants details. And eventually he gets around to asking, after some frustrations built up, you know, what is it that we do? And finally, Deidre Miro, who's a lieutenant in the ISB, speaks up and she says, "We're here to further security objectives by collecting intelligence, providing useful analysis, and conducting covert action." And he says, "Very good. That comes directly from the ISB mission statement, and it is completely wrong." And he describes the ISB as kind of being a healthcare provider, and that they identify germs from within and from without the body, so inside and outside the Empire, and then they treat that before it becomes a bigger issue. So an interesting analogy. What did you think about the impression of the ISB that he puts out there?
Well, you know, it's very similar to in the last episode, even with these other types of organizations, in that even as Cassian said, they're so fat and satisfied with themselves, they don't even realize what's going on. And I think that honestly, if there were more agents like Deidre Miro, the Empire probably would have survived better. But they're just all about, you know, themselves and their egos and whatnot. And I mean, I understand that Partagaz is got a job to do. And we know that the ISB is brutal and they are vicious. And, you know, we've heard all the stories and things about the way that they've handled things. But yeah, I mean, I just think it's a very cutthroat, belligerent kind of thing. But he does kind of put the two of them in their place when they're talking about the Ferrix incident with Blevin. And, you know, we need to be not fighting each other. We've got something else to worry about. But Miro was like, no, we have to look into these rebel cells, and this could be something that's increasing. And so she was on to something, but no one would listen to her.
Yeah, I mean, on the one hand, I appreciate his perspective, which is that we've been as successful as we've been because we verify things, we vet things. And, you know, she was going on about using her gut instinct. You know, she's found a pattern, but she hasn't really vetted the pattern yet. She hasn't expended the resources to go there and verify that there's a connection between all these looking events. How many police dramas have you seen, or detective stories where, you know, some detective has like talked about the importance of going on your gut there? That's Deidre. And, you know, of course, that's the character that always like ends up being right, because they learn when to trust their gut. And so I think both perspectives are valid. You know, his, which is, you know, we're effective and because we're thorough. And hers is that, you know, I don't have the resources right now to be that thorough. And, you know, she literally is trying to do what he was talking about, which was find these things and get rid of it before it becomes a problem. You know, exercise the cancer before it turns into a full-blown cancer. You know, in this case, you know, in her perspective, that's the rebellion. And she sees this organized rebellion starting to take hold, but she can't do anything about it. And of course, you know, this all comes about because she heard Blevin, another lieutenant in the ISB, talking about this star path that was recovered on Ferrix, which is in a sector that he's responsible for. And she is convinced that that was a unit that was stolen from Stiergard, which is in a sector she's responsible for, but they're kind of having a power struggle there. And Blevin doesn't want to turn over the reports. You know, it's like, it's not your business. It's not in your sector. And she's trying to make this case about a rebellion. So we do have a bit of a bureaucratic issue here, which is ultimately one of the things that dooms the Empire.
Mm-hmm. And we know that it was from Stiergard because Luthen actually said it in the last episode.
Yep. Yeah. Yeah. That was, she's absolutely right about that. Right. I mean, how many star paths are floating around out there, which makes this item seem like much more rare than we even knew it was to begin with. Mm-hmm. But anyway, so any last thoughts on Deidre before we get to the Priox Morlana portion of the ISB?
Well, she's one that I feel like is going to go one of two ways. She's either going to get like uber into the Empire and squashing this rebellion, or she's going to pull a Callus and she's going to go in the opposite direction. One of the two.
Well, the other thing is there's this, I kind of a parallel, a similarity between her and Cyril, right?
Yes. Mm-hmm.
You know, because mm-hmm. Cyril was told by Chief Hine to let the whole thing go on Morlana 1 with those dead security officers, you know, create a suitable accident. But then he pushed forward without any authority and landed them all in this hot water. But, you know, she's being told to stand down on this unless she's got, you know, more verified, vetted information. But is she going to? You know, she seems, you know, she seems to have that same type of, I don't see the sympathy in her that you eventually got with Callus. Now, they could make that hard right turn, which they do exactly what they did with Callus and Rebels.
Right.
And we could get that later. But at least at the moment, she's determined to root out this growing rebellion that she believes that she's discovered. And so I don't know. I don't know if she'll be more successful or she's going to have a similar downfall to Cyril's.
Mm-hmm. And similarly, you know, with Cyril, just another thing too, is as much of a jerk as I thought he was the last time, I kind of had a little bit of sympathy for him this time. I mean, I just feel like here he was trying to rectify a wrong. And in his eyes, he felt like there needed to be something done. And it was unjust to let this go. And it came down on him in a major way. And then he had to go home to his mama with his tail between his legs, you know, and he was so disheartened. And I kind of felt bad for the guy, even though mama slapped him in the face before she let him in the door. But I don't know what that was all about. But at any rate.
Yeah, I wasn't sure why she did that. I'm not sure if it was that she was upset that he put himself in that danger and made her worry.
Yeah. Like, I'm going to kill you, but I love you.
Yeah. You know, I'm so angry with you. I could. Yeah. But. But yeah, you know, just taking a step back from that. So we got to see Blevin show up on Priox Morlana or Morlana 1 and basically announce that that security division, that corporate security is being shut down and it's now under permanent imperial authority. And it's just kind of a, I think that's like an underappreciated moment from the chatter I've heard about this episode, because don't forget, you know, the Empire was established with the Senate and the Empire was having to like still try and keep all of them happy and get senatorial approval for things he wanted to do. But Cyril's actions opened the door for the Empire to come in and say, you're ineffective, you're out of here, we're mm-hmm. taking over. And so it's very insidious in that way. Mm-hmm. And I thought it was just a brilliant, brilliant move.
Yes. Good use of the word insidious.
No, thank you.
You're welcome.
Okay, well, let's get to the last bit about this. And unfortunately, I don't have as much time to talk about it as I want, but I think we can get through it pretty quickly. So Val gets dropped off on, or I'm sorry, Cassian, posing as Clem, gets dropped off on Aldhani, and he meets Vel. So Aldhani is a very agricultural world. I'm curious where they shot this. If it was like in the Highlands in Scotland, was it in like a South American place that also has these mountain regions where they raise goats and sheep? Because that's what it looked like to me. They're to pull off a job. They're going to basically steal the Imperial payroll for the sector from a garrison that's built into a dam of this sacred river. And they're going to go in there. They're going to unload the payroll into this, what is it called? A Valo freighter. and or Rono, a Rono hauler, and then they're going to fly the hauler out, and before the TIE fighters would be able to catch up with them, they're going to escape because there is this event, and it's called the Makani Braidani, which translates to the Eye of the Aldhani. And traditionally the Aldhani would meet at this temple, and they'd watch as the planet entered into a band of crystals that when they entered the atmosphere, they would heat up and explode, and it would look like 50 meteor showers at once. But they're going to time their escape just in time that they'll get beyond that, and they'll get the cover of that before the TIE fighters can get to them. Subtitle of this episode is Luthen 7, kind of like an Ocean's 11 type of heist movie here going on. What do you think about this crew? What do you think about their heist that they're planning? What do you think about this part of it?
Okay, so first of all, I think you're right. This was in Scotland, because when we were talking about the locations where they were shooting, Scotland was one of them, and it definitely looks like that. So I want to see this Eye of Aldhani. I think it's so, it's going to be so incredibly beautiful to see cinematically represented. But as far as the crew goes, of course, they're brand new. I mean, I'm warming up to them, not really getting a good feel on them yet. I mean, we've definitely got a couple of the tropes in terms of, you know, we've got the one that's definitely most untrusting of all, and then the one that wants to be more trusting and lighthearted and welcoming, and then, you know, the hard-headed leader and that type of thing. So, I mean, I can't really put my finger on it. Like, who exactly are they with? I mean, obviously Luthen, quote unquote, employs them, but where is the bigger picture? You know, in some ways I was thinking, okay, we're going to see Saw Gerrera, you know, anytime here. Like, maybe he's going to be part of this. And maybe he is. Maybe there's something going on, you know, in the background, but maybe he's not. Maybe that's a completely other different facet of this whole organization. So, you know, I think that that's one of those kind of storyline things that it's going to be a time will tell kind of a venture. But yeah, I mean, that's pretty much all that I have for the group as a whole. But what were your thoughts?
Well, I think we actually have some clues on this, because, you know, Cassian was described as a mercenary on this, and that was offensive to Vel, because the rest of them seemed to be like bought into this. You know, you've got the kid, Nemec, who's the one that fell asleep when he was supposed to be on watch. And then Skeen's the one that woke him up. And he was taught, he was like, you know, if you were doing watch for, and I can't remember all the groups, but he mentioned Saw Gerrera and the partisans there, you know, they'd just like shoot you and put your head on a pike just for fun for all of it there. So, you know, the rebellion as it comes to be is an alliance of various cells. This seems to be a different cell. They seem like they're into the cause here, that they aren't paid mercenaries the way that Cassian is in this moment here. And, you know, Vel's organized. We even got an Imperial, he's not a defector, but a double agent. There's your Callus right there, Jay. This Lieutenant Gorn, who shows up on a speeder bike. That was an awesome
bit
right there. And, you know, they're all angry because they haven't been informed that Cassian's joining this team. One that really intrigued me was Senta. And, you know, she's the dark complected woman in the group. And for a moment I was like, is she Canary? You know, I don't know if this is kind of a red herring for us and stuff like that, but I was half expecting Cassian and her to kind of get into a relationship about, or not a relationship, a conversation about where she came from, and there, you know, see if there's some sort of revelation about, you know, is this Cassian's long lost sister that he was looking for in the first episode, or what was going on there?
Ooh, that could be an interesting twist.
Mm-hmm. But yeah, I'm eager to see this plan. I want to get into some of the other Easter eggs and references that came up here. But before we do that, did you have anything else you want to say about this plan? I mean, whole thing ends with them giving Cassian a data pad and says, like, you know, here's some information about the Rono hauler, and here's where the consoles are. Here are some Aldhani commonly used phrases. And if you can translate the Arabic, it's like, that's what all the titles say. Yeah. Hauler controls, Aldhani phrases, and the like. And he has to learn all that by the next morning. He's like, well, can I finish my food first?
Yes.
And so, you know, that's where the episode ends, with you know, them getting ready to, you know, him getting ready to sit down and do all the stuff. And then I guess the next day they're going further into their planning. But did you have any other thoughts before we get into some of the other Easter eggs and references that came up in this episode?
Well, I mean, I'm fully, you know, aware that Cassian can definitely do it, because they, I think it was Luthen that mentioned that he can already speak three different languages. Mm-hmm. So he picks up on things very quickly, obviously. So no doubt that Cassian will have that wrapped up. But again, yeah, very interesting group for sure.
Indeed. Okay. So I literally have a list that's 20 some odd items long.
You do.
Of Easter eggs and references here. And that's because the last time I watched it, I turned on the closed captioning, and every time they mentioned a name or a planet, I went to Wikipedia and looked it up. And there really is a lot of stuff here. Let's take turns. What is one of your favorite Easter eggs references that came up in the course of this episode?
Oh, just kind of in passing, you heard the Hosnian Prime mentioned over the PA, mm-hmm. you know, on at the terminal. So that was definitely one of them. They mentioned Ryloth, so that was another one. And then I laughed when I heard increased construction shipments to Scarif. I thought, wonder why. But
right.
Interesting. Yeah. So, yeah, those were probably the big ones. And then, of course, everything in Luthen's gallery, which we can, you know, talk about here in just a minute. But what about you for the references? You mentioned the Rakata Star Empire thing, but what else?
Yeah. Cassian, of course, fought on Mimbom, which we saw in Solo, Star Wars Story. So that was kind of cool to see a reference there. And then, you know, there was a number, like you mentioned Hosnian Prime, but then, you know, the transport agency was the Telgorda Travel, which was originally from the Star Wars role-playing game several years ago. So that's a deep dive. Then the other planets that they mentioned was Plexus, which was just kind of thrown around as a mention in the Star Wars Uprising mobile game that's no longer in existence. And then Euphornis Major, which is a planet that got a single mention in Servants of the Empire, which is a Rebels tie-in book that was written by Jason Fry. And so, you know, they didn't just make up stuff. They went to the well for the references here. You know, some of the other Easter eggs here, you know, Luthen's shop alone, you know, had some incredible stuff in it. First off, it had Starkiller's helmet from The Force Unleashed sitting on top of a suit of armor. And that was in the background, you know, just, you know, sitting over, you know, Luthen's shoulder. That was absolutely incredible. What was something else that you saw there in the gallery?
Well, the first thing that caught my eye was the Mandalorian armor, like the breastplate and whatnot. Mm-hmm. And then it wasn't until after I had gone back and kind of stop motion things that I saw that something that looked like a Calicori in the gallery. So that was another one. But I was, you know, getting back to what you said about Starkiller's helmet. I mean, that's Legends. That's not even canon. And they're bringing it into this. I mean, that was a video game. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. So I'm just like, oh my gosh, like that's super cool.
Yeah, I thought it was really cool that we got a reference to The Force Unleashed and Knights of the Old Republic in this episode. Yeah. That helmet was really, really something. And that's what's kind of interesting about that is that, you know, in this alternate timeline for Star Wars, Starlet Killer in that form doesn't even come till after A New Hope. So it's just, you know, about that, you know, around that time. So it's kind of getting ahead of itself, but that was a cool thing. You know, one of the mentions that I liked in this was Arvala 6. And that is actually a brand new planet. Arvala 7 appeared in episode 2 of The Mandalorian. And that's where Din Djarin met Queel. And that's where the Razor Crest got taken apart by the Jawas, and he had to go back and get the parts. So that was kind of an interesting thing. I don't know if these were intended to be references, it was deliberate, or what the situation was, but amongst the languages that Luthen told Vel Cassian could speak, he threw out Mayo and Nari. And when you look them up, Mayo is not actually a language, but it was the name of an Abyssin that was in the Cantina in A New Hope. And Nari, again, also wasn't a language, but it was the name of the Jedi that got killed by the Inquisitors on Tatooine in Obi-Wan Kenobi. So I don't know if that's coincidence or if that was planned. And, you know, there was also a reference to Ryloth and there when they were increasing detention across the Ryloth sector. So, again, you know, just a ton of effort went into grounding everything that was thrown out as a name, as, you know, as a person or whatever, to something else that had previously occurred in Star Wars, whether it was canon or Legends for that matter.
Oh my gosh. Yeah. They've really pulled everything out. That's for sure.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Any last observations before we wrap this one up?
Not really. I mean, I think that, you know, as far as getting everything set up, like I said, it's just, there's a lot of little tendrils in a lot of different directions, and I am just completely intrigued to see where this all leads. So like I said, I'm really digging it, and I'm so excited to see what the payoff is going to be as far as, you know, Luthen and just all these things, and keep those Easter eggs coming, because that's so much fun. I that's part of the fun, I think, of especially having the closed captionings on, is being able to read through it as you're listening to it and being like, whoa, oh, okay, yeah, kind of a thing. So
yeah, if I can find time to go back and watch the first three episodes again, I may do that and see what I can pick up on. But, you know, with over an hour and a half worth of material, it was, you know, in those first three that just didn't have time before we got drawn into our discussion. But okay, I'd like to see what else they threw in there. Okay. Well, then that will do it for our discussion of episode 4, Aldhani of Andor, and this episode of Podcast Stardust. We hope you enjoyed it. And if you did, we hope you would consider subscribing to Podcast Stardust on your podcatcher choice. I'd like to remind you that you can also find all episodes of the podcast over on RetroZap.com, which is also home to several other great podcasts covering everything from the MCU and DC to Dune. There's a lot of other conversation going on over Animaniacs, superheroes, and much more. As always, we greatly appreciate your 5-star ratings and reviews on whatever podcatcher it is that you use, especially if that's Apple Podcasts. And don't forget to share the show and your favorite episodes on social media with your friends. Speaking of which, Jay, what are our social media contacts one more time?
All right. Well, we can easily be found on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram at Podcast Stardust. And we do have a Pinterest board and a YouTube channel, which has all of our past episodes, as well as some unboxing videos. And we do have a Discord room over on the RetroZap Discord server. So if you're up for some real-time chatter, just head over to our show page, click on the community tab, and you can join in the fun. And we do have a TeePublic store where you can pick up all kinds of Podcast Stardust swag. We have 7 different show logo designs available. So head on over to teepublic.com/user/podcaststardust and be on the lookout for some sales. They're always having some really good ones where you can pick up a new coffee mug, some stickers, magnets, all kinds of fun things. So again, that's teepublic.com/user/podcaststardust.
All right. And before we wrap it up, you want to remind everybody what's going on with cosplay?
Absolutely. So over on my Instagram, which is at j.snipscosplay, I am wrapping up the fourth sister very shortly. So you're going to be seeing all kinds of new shots for that. And I've got a couple of events coming up here in the middle of October, close to my hometown, where I will be appearing as Ahsoka and as the fourth sister. So I'm really excited about both of those. So again, check that out at j.snipscosplay.
All right, that'll do it for episode 473 of Podcast Stardust. Thanks for listening, everyone. And until next time, may the Force be with you.